privilege to be here, and especially to see all of you come out on a Saturday afternoon. I think in the United States, if we had a lecture on Saturday afternoon, there'd be three people here at most. So thank you very much for coming. Advanced directives are a topic that in some ways is regarded as very ordinary in bioethics, but I've learned in thinking about them a lot more the last 3 years than I had the previous 30 years in my life, that they're complex, they're a complicated issue, and they're morally complex, they're philosophically complex, and I'd like to explore that complexity. I nonetheless think they're very compelling, and so I've titled my remarks, Advanced Directives, Compelling and Problematic. What are they? They allow people to make known their wishes about medical treatment for times when they are no longer competent to participate in the decision making. They are called advance directives because they're made in advance of the situation in which they will be used. Those situations in which they will be used are always situations of incompetence. If the person is competent, you don't need the advance directive. They are not called advanced directives, a simple mistake that many students make when they write exams on this topic. Fundamentally, two kinds. We could get subkinds of various sorts, too. One kind has often gone by the term in the United States, a living will. It's a will that you make, but it's for a later time, not when you're dead, but when you're still alive. That's why it's termed a living will. Legally, they're sometimes called advance directive for healthcare. They are a written document that sets out what kind of medical interventions a person wants and does not want. A second kind is a healthcare proxy. Legally, will often be termed appointment of durable power of attorney for healthcare. That is, you appoint a person to hold your power of attorney for your health care. The individual is designated by the person to make health care decisions for them. Now, you could have one of these without the other, but as we will see later, it's probably advisable to have both of them. The rationale for directives is pretty intuitive, it's pretty obvious. We have liberties of self-determination about our own care when we're competent, and people should respect us in making decisions about our own care. Competent adults, therefore, have a right to refuse medical treatment. In fact, treatment without consent in the United States is legally, technically, battery. That it's invasion of the body without your consent just as much as a person who assaults you on the street would be guilty of battery. People don't lose their rights when they become incompetent. Their right to refuse medical treatment, for example, just has to be exercised by someone else. Advanced directives provide a way to instruct others how to exercise those rights for oneself. And they help proxies discern, and here we get to another division in how they should be interpreted, to discern either substituted judgment or best interest. I won't talk in detail about these two different concepts, but just intuitively, substituted judgment is made by a person later for you as an estimate, as a good guess, as good a guess as they can make, about what your judgment would be. They are substituting their judgment for yours, or another way of looking at it is they're getting your judgment to substitute for theirs. So it's really your judgment that they're expressing. The second concept, best interest, does not rely necessarily on interpreting the person's judgment, but says Right now, we have a person who's incompetent, incapable of judging their own best interest, so I'm going to say what is in their best interest. Now, I might go back to an advance directive and say, what did they think about what their best interest would be in this situation? That may give me some guide, not a definitive determination, but some guide as to what their best interest is now. We'll see that this gets very complex when we probe a couple cases later. What are the connections philosophically to traditions, larger traditions in moral philosophy? I've tried to draw connections with three of the primary views that I articulated several weeks ago in the introductory lecture on foundations of bioethics. With utilitarianism, for example, John Stuart Mill said, a person herself is ultimately the best judge of her own good. He thought that if we were just trying to maximize a person's good, we would rely first and foremost on the person's own judgment about what their good was, because their good was a subjectively experienced good, and only they have the final authority on what that experience, whether that experience is good or bad. For example, whether living another month is worth the suffering involved. He had utilitarian reasons, allegedly, for deriving this strong right of liberty to make these decisions. But they're utilitarian reasons. Now, some philosophers have said, no, they're not really utilitarian. If you probe his sentences, you find some other reasons as well as utilitarian ones. But Heath was convinced they were utilitarian reasons. That is, the subjective satisfaction, i.e. utility, to the person whose experience and life it is. Now, Kant had a very different moral philosophy focused on fairness and respect for persons. The fairness element is the so-called categorical imperative, or the universalization test. And his test was, can you will the maxim of your action to become a universal law? If you can, your act is permissible. If you can't, your act is not morally permitted, and you're obligated not to do it. Now, if we take a maxim for withholding or withdrawing treatment, life-saving medical treatment, life-extending medical treatment, when one is suffering, the maxim might be, to avoid suffering, I refuse, in a certain circumstance, one might want to fill it in, I refuse life-extending treatment and accept a natural death. Now, could you will that everyone in the universe who was in a situation where they too would have this desire in order to avoid suffering, don't take medical, life-extending medical treatment, that they would follow through on that? Yes, no contradiction is created by people doing that. So this act is permissible. It doesn't tell you whether it's obligatory, it just says it's permissible. But furthermore, following advanced directives respects people as decision-making agents. And Kant had a second version of his test, which was we must treat people never merely as means, but always also as ends in themselves. Ends in themselves means respect the fact that as a human being, they are a rational decision-making agent. And this is the powerful push behind having advanced directives and people follow, later people, when you're incompetent, following them. Now, in natural law ethics, which is in part the Roman Catholic tradition, but it goes much broader than that, there might be a justification for advanced directives in many circumstances because refusing extraordinary care is not intentionally destroying life. You're not allowed to intentionally destroy one of the basic goods, natural goods of life, natural goods of human existence, one of which is life. But refusing extraordinary care is not intentionally destroying life. It's letting death come. And letting death come is not a violation of any natural good. Now, this can be a slippery distinction here, but this is what the tradition of natural law ethics has said in typical cases of refusing medical treatment. Now, some cases of refusing medical treatment might not fit this paradigm note, so it could get considerably more complicated. Now, in the United States, there's a very important precedent case In re Quinlan, decided in 1976. Parents wanted their daughter, Karen Ann Quinlan, who was in persistent vegetative state, to be removed from a ventilator and allowed to die a natural death. There were no controversies here about whether she was in PBS. She would not come out of this condition into consciousness, or certainly not into any kind of competence. She did not have a written directive, but the question was whether her parents were situated to express what she would have wanted. And they thought she would have wanted in this situation just to be allowed to die and not to be sustained by a ventilator any longer. The hospital refused to remove the ventilator, saying that that would be homicide. The act of removing the ventilator would be killing her. It was, the hospital said, quite predictable, certainly maybe not absolutely predictable that she would die when the ventilator was removed, but there was a high risk that she would die without the ventilator. You subject somebody to a very high risk, and if the risk turns out to come about, if the bad thing that's risked comes about, you can be guilty of murder, even though it wasn't absolutely certain when you shot the person that they were going to die. Right? I mean, this situation is similar here. The New Jersey Supreme Court ruled for the parents. After the ventilator was removed, interestingly, Karen began breathing on her own and survived another 9 years in PBS. This isn't integral to the decision, but it's an interesting fact about the case. They were parents and caregivers all during this time. They visited her very regularly. There was a model, faithful parents to their daughter throughout this. The New Jersey Supreme Court said, if you look at the more detailed substance of the decision, that removing a ventilator is not homicide, is not killing the patient, but is allowing death from underlying causes to occur. Now, we might think this judgment is a little suspicious, because after all, removal of a ventilator by the parents would perhaps have been homicide. Certainly, if an unauthorized person in the hospital had just pulled the ventilator, they would be vulnerable to homicide charges. So, no, it's a physician who's authorized to remove the ventilator with the proper decisions behind that, like the consent, even request of the family, the proper spokesperson for the patient. But one suggestion is that, more plausibly perhaps, disconnecting the ventilator does kill the patient. It's an action, it leads to death, at least in most cases, but it's a permissible killing. This is only one interpretation of it. But it gets you out of the quandary posed by the previous suspicion. Well, removal by an unauthorized person would be homicide. Why isn't removal by a doctor also an action rather than merely letting death come? This raises, of course, in part, it's not the only question that the Quinlan case raised at all, but it is certainly one, the withholding versus withdrawing distinction. Now, some have thought that withholding is permissible, but that withdrawing once treatment is started is wrong. Withdrawing is an action that kills, if what's withdrawn is life-extending treatment, not merely an omission that lets nature take its course. This view that there's a strong difference between withholding or even really any difference at all between withholding and withdrawing morally, has now largely been rejected. One of the initial rejections of that distinction as morally relevant was in the Quinlan case. And some of the observations that have been made for saying that if withholding is justified, withdrawing is also justified are that if we cannot later withdraw a treatment, we will have an undue incentive not to start it. If we can start it, however, and know that we're still at liberty to withdraw it if it doesn't work out, we'll start it, and sometimes it will do a lot of good, and we won't have to withdraw it. Or we can withdraw it after the person has revived so they can still survive after withdrawing it. Furthermore, withdrawing is just as much letting nature take its course as withholding is. If one is letting nature take its course, why isn't the other letting nature take its course? And neither is active intentional killing. Or, I might have put in here on this line, or both are intentional killing. It's not that one can be intentional killing and the other not. The conclusion for our advanced directives of this discussion is that in a directive, a person may request withdrawing just as much as they may request withholding of medical treatment. Now, one view after this all settled down in the 80s and 90s in the United States among people who deal with the situations of incompetent patients whose wishes are interpreted often by advanced directives, or could be interpreted if they had an advanced directive, is a view published by two authors, Fagerlin and Schneider, that basically advanced directives are a failure. Now, they're making a factual descriptive judgment here. They're not engaging in a fundamentally moral argument. They're saying, number one, they're not often used, and at the time in 2004 when their article was written, only 18% of U.S. adults had advanced directives. Admittedly, 10 years later, that had increased to 32% and to 42% if a healthcare proxy is also included. Some people have only a proxy, but not substantive advanced directive. And it had increased to 72% of the elderly. The elderly here are defined as those over 65. But furthermore, even if 72% of the people who are most vulnerable to the situations where the advanced directives would be needed is a fairly high number, still there are huge problems, these two authors said. An effective living will have to speak in advance to many possible treatments for many different medical situations. But this is simply impossible to put in a reasonable length directive. And even if the person were willing to write 15 pages to detail all this, they just wouldn't know enough to write it. And they wouldn't be able to imagine in sufficient detail all the circumstances which might come about. In fact, they couldn't even imagine the majority of circumstances under which they are later going to be, their spokespersons are going to be faced with making a decision. Preferences also change. How often does an advance directive need to be updated? Is one 20 years old no longer any good? What if the person just orally said 2 months or 1 week or 1 day before they fell into incompetence? Yeah, that still holds. Does the oral consent still count? Or do they have to sign another directive or a reiteration of the directive? Furthermore, the preferences are often hard to state consistently and clearly. If one got into the details of directives, one would realize that. Lawyers deal with these consistency and clarity problems all the time. And healthcare providers have to deal with them too. A better alternative, Fagerlin and Schneider suggest, is a healthcare proxy and good conversation. with the people who are going to be your spokespersons. Now, the observation in defense of advanced directives is, well, yes, healthcare proxies and good conversation are very important, but also a directive can be helpful. Directives about specific things that you anticipate. Now, those are usually going to be things that you've only recently come on. So if you have a certain kind of cancer, for example, and you know, learn a little bit enough about the trajectory for that and what kinds of care might be needed, what care could extend your life another month, in what certain situations, maybe another year, whatever, you could actually write a quite specific advance directive for your new situation. And that would be very helpful. But that's, of course, not an old directive. So we always have to be alert to the need for updating directives. Now, in addition to the responses to Fagerlin and Schneider's practical objections to the usefulness of advanced directives, there is a big moral philosophical challenge that we must wrestle with. If you don't wrestle with this challenge, you just haven't gotten the richness of the issues around advanced directives. It's come to be known in the literature as the then-self, now-self problem. We'll get to the two authors who brought the problem most prominently to the attention of bioethics circles in a minute. But in the meantime, just to explain the problem. The person who wrote the directive has changed once they're incompetent. Not in all, but in many kinds of incompetence, they will not remember writing their directive. They don't care about autonomy any longer. And often they don't care about other values that motivated them to write the substantive things they wrote in their directive. They may not find the diminished life that they spoke to in their directive and said, I don't want to be kept alive in that circumstance, unbearable, whereas previously they had thought it would be unbearable. And now they may have little concern about being a burden to loved ones, something they thought was very important for not extending their lives, for example, for years and years in severe dementia, maybe, when they wrote their directive. So what gives the then self authority over the now self? Autonomy cannot be invoked. The autonomy was autonomy of the person who wrote the directive. The now self, the current patient, doesn't have autonomy. So if you said, well, autonomy needs to be respected, you're already, as philosophers would say, siding with the then self. You're begging the question in favor of the then self, but we're having an argument about whether the then self should have authority over the now self. You can't cite the then-self as having some authority here in order to settle the question of whether the then-self should have authority over the now-self. Right? That would be unfair as an argument. Let's take some case studies. Now, in some cases, we're going to say, I think, intuitively, the then-self still counts. In other cases, we will say, well, maybe the then self shouldn't count much. So engage with me in a bit of reflection. These are four of five famous cases, or cases that Norman Cantor wrote in a very short piece that is in Bonnie Steinbach's and colleagues' textbook on ethical issues in modern medicine, has been since they first edited it, and probably always will be, because they're terrific. You can consult them. They're in two pages, Norman Cantor's beautiful article back in 93, posed this problem. Here are four of these cases. A Jehovah's Witness has an advance directive refusing blood transfusion, as most Jehovah's Witnesses, if they write an advance directive, will put in their directive. Now this person is senile and, relatively speaking, happy, not exercise, not exasperated, stressed, repeatedly anxious, repeatedly crying, et cetera, but relatively peaceful and happy. they encounter a medical circumstance under which they will not be able to live without a likely without a transfusion. Or maybe they could live, but they'll be much more compromised if they don't get a transfusion. Should we go against their directive and give the transfusion? Any comments?
You need to add she doesn't remember having written the directive.
Sure, yes, she's senile enough.
Right. Always witnessing.
Yeah, she doesn't know she's at as a, now she doesn't know she has a directive, and now she doesn't know she's a Jehovah's Witness. Because she's incapable, her cognitive capacity is just, she's incapable of understanding what being a Jehovah's Witness was. Maybe she can recognize a word, but you know, that's a sort of reflex to the sound of a word. Okay, so what do? Follow the directive or not? She's got a good life, a reasonably good life for her. Now, if we keep her alive with a blood transfusion, and she won't have any life at all if we don't do the blood transfusion. Yes?
Maybe for one, in my perspective, it might sound like a slap in the face to the religious, but the prohibition due to the Jehovah's Witness. Or the religion only holds if there is someone to support it. But if the patient herself don't even support this kind of belief, then I might assume that it's an automatic relinquish, that she has automatically relinquished the religion and the rule for the Jehovah's Witness will never apply to her. So if I were the physician, I might suggest a transfusion for her.
Okay, that's one view. Contrary expressions? Reservations about that? Let's spruce up the... Go ahead.
But I think that in order to honor what she had already expressed her wish previously, and in the situation that we face in this moment, I would rather to wait whether she has any other unbearable situation without treatment, then she may be worse off. So I would take the best interest approach first and then look back. Whether
you give her the transfusion.
No, I mean, we still have to sort out whether there's any other information that I could get. If she's now unconscious, looks happy, no objections from other members of the family, then I would just honor what she has expressed previously and then, okay, no transfusion. Because that's what she wants initially. So this is the approach that I would adopt.
Well, she didn't want it, but can you say any longer that she doesn't want it?
No, unless the situation, she looks quite irritable.
She's not irritated.
She's just uncomfortably, let's say. Mm-hmm. She's unconscious, comatose, no struggling, and it seems everything is fine.
No, she's conscious. She's just very senile. She's incompetent. Unable to understand what a decision now would be.
I would just honor her decision initially expressed. That is no transfusion.
And why honor it when she is now appears her best interest would be to live longer in her pleasant current state?
Yes, of course, we might, using your original argument, the then self versus the now self, but she isn't expressing her now self, at least. Unless she expresses it, okay, I want a relinquishment of my wish. I now want transfusion. Doctor, please give me. Unless she expresses it.
I see. That's an interesting thing. The then self expressed itself. The now self doesn't express itself. She may be happy, but it doesn't express itself. We could put in other details. Suppose you had asked her to the first person who spoke, I might say, well, what if we put in this detail? That in her last days of competence, before she became so senile that she's no longer competent, no longer able to respond to a query about this, she said in response to the question, here in the directive, you say you're an advanced, you're a Jehovah's Witness, and you don't want a blood transfusion. Are you still a Jehovah's Witness? And she says, yeah, sure. Of course I'm a Jehovah's Witness. Have been all my life. I am the... That's who I am. That's who I am. Does that carry over now to the now self? This was just before she went into incompetence. Is she still a Jehovah's Witness?
Even if she did not say that, unless you said that being seen now, automatically the religion aspect of it is gone. Yep. If being senile should not take away the person's original religion, then there's no reason that before the person is senile, he or she has already made the advance directive saying no transfusion. So all the other things are not relevant.
Yeah, there's a fundamental question here about the connection between a religious belief and personal identity. And this is not an easy question. What personal identity is, what individual personal identity is complex. But one view is that personal identity, from a human person attentive view, is in part a narrative or a story that the person herself makes slash tells slash creates about herself. That's the marvelously creative thing about human beings. And one of the things involved in religious liberty is that people can choose to be, to have a certain religious identity. Now, they can fluctuate in and out, so in certain kinds of cases, we might imagine we're not sure she is a Jehovah's Witness anymore. But if she always had been, and she really solidly a faithful Jehovah's Witness, why should we remove that from her identity now? Right.
Of not giving transfusion.
That's right. That's right. Because she still is a Jehovah's Witness, even if she can't conceptualize anymore what it is to be a Jehovah's Witness. Believe me, that you can begin to understand that these are complex issues here. But most of us, I think, in our society would say, yeah, you don't lose your religious identity when you go into incompetence. And if we say that, then she's still a Jehovah's Witness, and presumably we should honor her directly. Now,
one more point on the regular basis, religious belief on person probably is not a major concern here, because even though one has to be secular for whole life, refusal of blood transfusion at the time of making advance directive is to make sure that if he cannot make, is not capable of making decision, someone will follow what he wants at that moment of time. Now, of course, that person has the power to supersede what he made beforehand, given the fact that he's capable, meaning that he can understand what the physicians say, recall what the physicians say, have his own rationale, be it you believe or not, then you should follow the instruction from that patient. So it depends on
Yes, we encounter another dimension, which I'll get to at the very end. I don't think it's quite as complicated as the then self, now self problem, but it's the change of mind challenge to advanced directives. But now let's move to a case, and I'm not going to do all four of these cases, or we won't get through with other things I want to say. But let's just take the second one, because it also involves a religious belief. This person has an advanced directive in favor of all aggressive life-saving, even when one is in when he would be in suffering, when he would be suffering a lot, in having his life extended. Okay? And he wants this, he wrote this directive because he sees suffering as redemptive. It's, in his religious view, it's part of what we human beings have to do to gain redemption. Now, this isn't necessarily all that ordinary religious view, but it's not one that's extremely uncommon. I mean, there are a number of religious views, certainly versions of Christianity, which regard suffering as, no matter how extreme it is, as redemptive. Now, the person is in terrible pain, they're incompetent, they're not remotely capable of understanding their directive, or of reiterating it, or of retracting it. Do we sedate the patient to take them out of pain? The person did not say, "Don't sedate me," although they did say, "Suffering is redemptive, and I want to be kept alive no matter how much I'm suffering." Or do we just cease the life-prolonging care? Or do we do both? Or do we do neither? Let the person, that would be to let the person, we would give life-prolonging care, but not sedate, and the person would live in great pain, which could be avoided if we went against their advanced directive. Now does the now self become so important that it overrides the then self? I lead you to wrestle with the case. It's a tougher case in a way than the Jehovah's Witness case. Since I'll refer to the last case later at one point, the sociology professor, this is an extreme case, but you know, there may be actual real instances of something like this. A person writes an advance directive requesting no life-saving treatment once she can no longer read a sociology text. She herself is an author of several such texts. She has been a totally absorbed, engaged, wonderful philosophy, sociology professor and scholar for her life. She says that you know this part of the advance directive, but now she's had a stroke, is permanently incapable of reading anything like a sociology text, much less a lot of other things. She's not in pain, however, and she still modestly enjoys music. She'll smile, make a few sounds, maybe in response to certain kinds of music. She's not distressed. She's not anxious or visibly irritated. She had included in the things she was refusing life-saving treatment, the forms of life-saving treatment she refused, feeding tube. She explicitly said, no medically assisted nutrition or hydration. Once she got to a point where she could no longer read. Do we provide a feeding tube here? How differently do we think about this case than the Jehovah's Witness case? Maybe a little bit, because her view seems a little bit more extreme, and maybe a bit ignorant. She thought life wouldn't be worth living if she couldn't read a text.
Jehovah's Witness thinks they'll lose eternal life.
One thing I'll know later is if the reason for her directive was that she thought she could not bear her own life when she wasn't able to read, that she'd be insufferably bored, for example. And that's why she wrote this directive saying, don't keep me alive in those situations. Now we get to the real situation. She's not insufferably bored. She doesn't even have the capacity for boredom anymore. So the reason she had for writing this directive isn't there in the real case anymore. In fact, she finds her life quite bearable, insofar as she can find any life bearable, and by her behavior, she finds it bearable. So she's really changed her mind. That's a possibility here that we got a change of mind occurring, a change in the reason she had for her directive, not an explicit change in the directive itself. Would that count? Well, these are challenging dimensions. Yes, Edgar. Okay.
I'm not going to belabor the point, But something I learned today, I didn't realize that, but obviously it could be done that way. The advanced directive could be not just refusing, but also advanced directive for aggressive or any kind of thing. And to me, refusing is one thing. Advanced directive to do a number of things, like in this case, aggressive life-saving because suffering is seen as redemptive, so on and so forth. The question is whether this should be allowed in the first place.
Well, in the United States, legally, it's certainly allowed. An advance directive requesting aggressive treatment.
No, you cannot have an advance directive to say, cut me up or, you know, and make me suffer. No, it doesn't make sense in that sense. So I don't want to belabor it.
If I could just jump in here, I think you're making a very important point, and I actually think it's two separate but related points. One is, you don't have the right to everything that might prolong your life. What if it costs, you know, $1 billion, right? So you have a right to refuse treatment, so there's that difference. But I think you're also bringing up a question about physician role, which would be when you said not to right to cut up. Suppose somebody comes to you and says, this arm doesn't belong to me, chop it off. Do you have an obligation? You might say, no, there's something, you know, wrong with what you're asking. So that does, both of those things do stick out in that particular case, and I think are very important, both whether you have a right to everything.
Well, let's suppose ordinary aggressive care. Okay. The advance directive reads ordinary, I want all ordinary aggressive care.
That normally would be.
Yeah, normally to be given. Even if I'm left, even if my life is extended by that care into continued suffering.
Then the other point, without going deeper into the second, the fourth example, it would have been easier. That's why you said it earlier, that it would be nice not only to have an advance directive that you do it for yourself, but have a proxy. Now, if someone signed also a proxy, the proxy might help, okay? But without the proxy, the advance directive saying no life-saving treatment, no longer read sociology text, then you just have to honor. You just don't second guess. But when you have a proxy, then you can second guess.
Yes, very good. Two things that are important there. The proxy is important in helping later people understand or giving voice to the person's reasons for their directive. The proxy is likely to understand more about the reasons this person had for writing this directive than was actually in the directive. But also, a person can put in the directive something about their reasons. If there are things in the directive that rather stand out and can be predicted were certain situations to unfold to spark controversy, but you still have reasons for putting those things in your advance directive, state the reasons. That will help later. Also, naming a proxy who is close to you, with whom you've had conversations about these matters. Again, we get back to proxy and conversation are really important. Maybe even stating reasons in the directive are really important to the actual use of directives in these difficult dilemma situations. Well, just to reiterate the defense of the now self, it isn't the only defense of the It isn't just a defense of the now self, it's a defense of a certain kind of position about the now self. Dresser and Robertson, two authors, did I not put the footnote on them? At any rate, said, the interests of a patient have changed when they become incompetent, often, not always. Respect for autonomy cannot override best interests. Currently, no autonomy is left. We've gone over that. Present autonomy is simply a misnomer. It's the person's previous autonomy. It's no longer relevant to the current patient. Only treating the current patient to satisfy her current best interest can respect the patient and be good care. Period. End of the matter, they thought. Advanced directives are really not relevant because they don't speak to how to interpret best interest, because you can't speak in advance about that. Now, immediately or soon after they expressed this position, Nancy Roden wrote the refutation, what she thought was the refutation here, and it's to many of us now, the singular most compelling statement in response to Dresser and Robertson. She said previous wishes must count. The best interest view of the now self must include more than currently experienced interest, the experience that the now self currently experienced, the interest they now currently experience. Otherwise, we will have treated that person as if she had never been competent. Because what we do with a patient who's never been competent is we say, there are no wishes to look back to. We are obligated to treat them solely on the basis of their current best interests. That's a compelling position about how we should think in treating never competent patients. But if you've been competent, think what it would be to go through our lives realizing that if we become incompetent, we're going to be treated exactly the same way when we're incompetent as if we had never been competent. She says that that's unacceptable. We must never treat a previously competent person that way. It would ignore most of the elements in her life that have made her the person she is. This gets back to identity again. Such treatment is incompatible with respect for persons. The now self is not all there is to the person. Well, this debate goes on and on. Dresser and Robertson didn't fold at this point. And one person, Ronald Dworkin, came along with, and I will take just a bit of time on this, because it, I think, is a very interesting move. Ronald Dworkin's a very noted philosopher who said, in response to the Dresser-Robertson position, well, let's give them the benefit of the doubt. Autonomy doesn't count anymore, because that's the autonomy of the previous self. What about the current self? What interests do they have? And Dworkin said, they have several kinds of interests now. One kind of interest they have now, he called experiential interest. They derive from first order desires and beliefs. For example, I enjoy my life now. I have an interest in living. I don't have to think about why I enjoy my life. I don't have to endorse that with another kind of reflection. I just enjoy my life now, so I have an interest in living. I experience my enjoyment of life. I have an interest in living. Critical interests are different. They derive from second-order desires, beliefs, and values. That is, desires, beliefs, and values about first-order desires. They're often highly reflective and considered. They're convictions, for example, about what helps to make my life good on the whole. I don't want to end my life in months or years of suffering out of which, and incompetence out of which I will not emerge. For example, to take one judgment. These critical interests are represented by the narrative that a person tells, creating, constituting their identity. At least that's one interpretation. Now, these critical interests are not dependent on current experience. One example of a critical interest is an interest we have after we die. Posthumous interests, for example, that one's will be carried out, or that one's reputation not be demeaned and be preserved. You will not be conscious of your reputation being demeaned, impugned, but do you not have an interest in your reputation not being impugned? Well, you could say only your survivors have an interest in that. Only the people who love you later are going to have an interest in that. But wait a minute, we think about our lives now, I think we would probably generally come back to the point that we believe we have posthumous interests. But we don't experience them at the time. So there are some things that are not interests that are not experienced at the time. Furthermore, some interests, what satisfies some interests, though it can be experienced sometime, it does not have to be. We have an interest in having done well to our children, for example. Sometimes we are experiencing that satisfaction, and sometimes we are not. But even when we're not experiencing it, we still have an interest in having done well to our children. Current interests are still, Dworkin insisted, current, critical interests are still current interests of the now self. They were formed in the then self, but they're still current interests. Now, what overall, when you got both these kinds of interests, is a person's current best interest? We would have to weigh the two together, and I will pass up a couple slides here in the interest. Dworkin thought always the critical interests trumped because they were the most interests, important interests, because they were second order interests. We endorsed them. That's the second order. We think about our interests and we endorse them, and that always makes critical interests more important. But Bonnie Steinbach and I have argued that, in fact, that argument doesn't work, shouldn't work, because we should look at what the balance of experienced and experiential and, on the other hand, critical interests are in the current life of an incompetent patient. The proposal that came out of our thinking is a so-called sliding scale. How important are the critical interests represented in the advanced directive? How much experiential interest in survival does the patient now have, if the primary interest that we're discussing is how important is it to them that they still live? A sliding scale would say the authority of an advanced directive and the weight of its critical interest it expresses gains as the critical interest in not surviving is strong because the directive was very clear, for example, and reasons were given for it. So we got a sense of how important this directive was in the life of that person. And also, as the capacity, the strength of a directive gains, as the capacity to enjoy life and appreciate survival is weak. And if the cognitive situation is one in which you cannot appreciate survival when you get to it tomorrow, you can't appreciate having survived, and you cannot anticipate surviving to tomorrow now, how strong is your experiential interest in surviving? It's still some interest if you're not suffering, but how great is it? Pass up the details here. Now, a different challenge is change of mind. A basic assumption we make about advanced directives is that by voluntary competent decision, any directive can be changed, can always be changed. But after a person loses competence, what, if any, changes of mind can alter the directive's authority? Now, by authority, I don't mean absolute authority, I just mean the kind of authority that compels us to consider it seriously as one important factor in the situation. If the person is not competent to write a new directive, I would argue that there's still another change of mind that might be possible, that is a kind of change of mind, though it's not a change of mind in the directive itself, but it's a change of mind relative to the very authority of the directive. Namely, if what motivates the person to write at the directive and what brings them into operation, becoming incompetent, also brings changes in the values, attitudes, desires that were the basis of the directive, then that throws those changes later in incompetence, throw that directive's authority into doubt. This is a complicated matter. I don't want to make it appear too simple. Interpreting it, this kind of thing to have happened is a very delicate matter. But it points to, we will be able to make some interpretations of this sort, that a person even after incompetence has, in the relevant sense of change of mind, has changed their mind sufficient to throw the authority of their directive into question. If they've stated or conveyed the reasons for the substance of their directive to the persons they talked with about the directive, perhaps in the directive itself. And importantly, by naming a proxy who understands, presumably, the reasons the person had for their directive. So changes of mind are not really challenges to the whole business of whether directives are things we ought to write and follow. They are problems for a particular directive because if the person has changed their mind, then that authority, then the authority of that directive is questionable. Sorry, I should have flipped to this earlier. Now, what is an effective directive? To be effective, a directive will state measures that are and are not to be used in specified sorts of conditions. Yes, no on a treatment means little without a sense of the situation to which that request applies. If I say, I never want a ventilator, wait a minute. What about a situation where a ventilator could tide you over for 3 days and you'd come out of it able to go home and start bowling and golfing again? Really? You don't want a ventilator in that situation? You should never just state, I never want a particular measure. Now, there may be rare cases where one could do that plausibly, but generally not. So it's always treatment condition connections to which one speaks in a directive, for them to be clear. State and explain, furthermore, the most important reasons for the directive substance. Without that, the proxy gains little guidance from the directive in all those circumstances that are not specifically mentioned in the directive, but there are always going to be such circumstances. Finally, it should be accompanied by appointment of a proxy and by discussion. We've already uncovered why that's important. Now, the legal strategy for directives is itself another matter that's controversial. One may not think controversial, but there are some important decisions here. Common law and case law precedent often protect the basic idea behind directives, that incompetence does not lose people their rights. That's the fundamental intuition stated in Quinlan case in the United States. Legislative authorization may describe the scope of directives that gain explicit state sanction and support, but this may lead people. It's not a logical conclusion they should come to, but it may lead people to see the explicitly legally authorized directives as confined to that scope, the scope stated in the legislation that blessed them. Now, good legislation that blesses a certain scope of directives should probably say, we are not saying that legally important directives are confined only to this scope. Unless, of course, the legislators who pass it really want to confine directives only to that scope. For example, to terminal illness. But there are many circumstances in addition to terminal illness that people write directives for. It's possible that by explicitly legislatively approving directives, that one could lead to either the correct or the mistaken assumption that directives are confined to that scope. Common law probably doesn't limit directives to any of these three scopes mentioned here. But if legislation does tend to, in practical terms, to limit them to that, should we actually legislate about advanced directives, or should we just leave it to common law? That's an open question. And you find different states in the United States doing different things on that score. My conclusion would be that current and previous wishes count for essentially the reason of Nancy Roden's that we've publicly previously discussed. The last line here, I think claiming that we should treat a previously competent person no differently than a never competent person just can't pass the test of public reason. Some of you will hear more from Hamlan Lee in a presentation on Tuesday at a workshop next week about public reason. But if we take this question, should a previously competent person be treated the same way as a never competent person? I think in any public discussion, we would probably get pretty resounding rejection of that equivalent treatment. There should be a difference. Previous wishes should count. Now, exactly for what they should count and how much is still open because of the then-self, now-self difficulty. And I want to acknowledge with gratitude the assistance of Bonnie Steinbach, here, your next speaker, who has taught this subject more recently than I have in this lecture. We have 20 to 25 minutes for discussion. Yes. Dr. Che.
Thanks for your very nice lecture. I just want to bring out one perspective which might not have been covered in your talk. That is about validity of an advanced directive. Validity of an advanced directive.
The authority?
Validity. Valid. Whether the directive is valid or not.
Valid.
Validity
of it.
Validity, sorry. The reason why I want to bring out this point is that because I think in most cases we consider an advanced refusal of life sustaining treatment legally binding if it is valid and
yes.
applicable. So judging from, if we stick to this position and look back to the case of that sociology professor, mm-hmm. The reason why I think people would think that the situation of the sociology professor may be slightly different from that Jehovah's Witness is that for the sociology professor, one may argue that he has misunderstood that a stroke life is miserable, is equal to a miserable life. So she made that directive that said to say that when she couldn't read, then she wanted to withdraw everything. So unless she has stated clearly that in her directive, that when she has this illness, despite having a life that looks nice, she mm-hmm. still doesn't mm-hmm. want, unless she has written clearly mm-hmm. like that. Mm-hmm. If not, I think people can raise an argument mm-hmm. to say that, well, he might have misunderstood that the illness will definitely lead to a miserable life. And now she's not miserable. She's actually enjoying her life. And so going back to the validity point, then because we say that an advanced directive may not be valid if the patient was not properly informed. So we argue that because she has misunderstood the outcome of the illness, she thought that it will definitely lead to a miserable life. And that was really not adequate information about the prognosis. And without adequate information about prognosis, we can argue that this is not, might not be valid. Of course, this is not an easy question. We also need a lot of discussion with his family to see what she means. So what I'm saying is that unless she has explicitly stated clearly in her advanced directive, in that case, we have to honor. But if not, if you just say that if I couldn't read, then mm-hmm. I don't want what treatment, we can still question the validity of the directive. So I just want to bring out this perspective.
Very good things to remind us all of. I should have put in another slide about the basic conditions of validity of an advanced directive at all. Voluntariness,
yes.
I was assuming that, and some threshold of knowledgeability that is not utter ignorance. But we get into big controversies about how knowledgeable a person should be required to be to have a valid directive. Because
yes.
we're not all experts, number one, and we can't see the future, number two.
In our guideline, we say it's properly informed. But of course, how
properly
do you define
informed.
Properly
yes.
informed?
It is the obligation of people to, certainly anybody who has a consultative role in relation to the person writing the directive, to see that they're informed about the conditions and measures to which they speak in the directive. That can be either a tall order or a relatively small order. It's a relatively small order if the person writing the directive has had a lot of direct experience with the sorts of conditions and measures they're speaking to. But in other cases, it can be a really tall order. And what is that threshold of requisite knowledge that gives validity to a directive? That's a tough question. And thank you for calling it to our attention. I was bringing it in only through the back door, namely, what would constitute a change of mind in the sociology professors. But you've already handled another version of that, which is suppose the sociology professor says, I'm writing this directive that I don't want to be kept alive if I can't read the text anymore, even for the condition under which I'm happy in that circumstance. But of course, some people might argue that we should make that kind of directive, that I should not be kept alive even if I'm happy, itself an invalid directive, because we just say that legally it's not backed up. Now, common law will generally not do that, because...
What do you mean, not backed up?
Well, if whoever's using the advance directive, it can be physicians, it can be a proxy for the person, they're citing the advance directive as a reason for doing this or not doing a certain thing. And if legally the state has said, back up one step further. If whoever has to carry out the directive then refuses to do it, a family cites the directive, a proxy cites the directive, it's very clear what the directive says. The physicians or the hospital says, or the nursing home says, no, we're not going to carry it out. You've got legal blows. They come to legal blows. And suppose either by case law or by legislation, the state has waded in and said directives of a certain sort are not legally valid. People don't have to follow them. The hospital doesn't have to follow them. The nursing home doesn't have to follow them. Doctors don't have to follow them. That's a different situation than where we haven't limited or bridled the scope of the directives that are considered valid. In some situations, people want to limit the scope of legally valid directives to terminal illness. But if autonomy and previous wishes of the patient in defining their life are important, as I've argued they are, then why would you limit the scope of directives to terminal illness? Yes. But nonetheless, your point is absolutely correct. We do have a prior question here about what is legal validity.
But why would it only have to do with advanced directives? I mean, why couldn't the state say you can't refuse life-sustaining treatment?
That's right.
So in the United States and in England, in common law, Canada, Australia, we think people do have that right. But there may be places that say life is so important that people have no right to refuse treatment that is deemed life-extending. It's not unique to advanced directives. That's the point.
No, it may not be unique, but we could draw a distinction. We could say that people have a right to refuse medical treatment even when the situation is not one of terminal illness at all and they've got a good life ahead of them if they would only accept the treatment. When they're competent, they still have a right to refuse that. And we will not impose that treatment on them. But we might also say as a society that they don't have a right to have that wish enforced in their incompetent later state by an advance directive. We could draw a distinction. Now, if you think the wishes represented in a directive, especially if it's thoughtful and knowledgeable, demand attention, even if it's problematic how we interpret them, even when change of mind possibilities come up, et cetera, if fundamentally these previous wishes demand attention, then why would we say that a person has a right to refuse life-saving medical treatment even if it's not a terminal illness situation when they're competent, but they don't have a right to write an advance directive that should be followed about the same situation? Again, we get back to arguments about how important the previous wishes count at a later time. And it's plausible, I would argue, I wouldn't necessarily want to do it myself if I were a legislator or a judge, but it's, I don't think, implausible for society to say, because of the then self, now self problem, there are differences. We won't impose treatment on you ever in if you're competent, but we sometimes will against your advanced directive. Nonetheless, I do think the burden of proof is on the party who wants to say there should be a difference. Absolutely.
Well, the discussion before had reminded me of something. Maybe in the advanced directives, we can also specify the exceptions of the directives. That means the patients can specify in which circumstances that the directives would have a lower priority than the interests of the current self, which is no longer incompetent. In the case of the sociology professor, maybe if there are the exception of the directives is specified and it validates the current self's interests or decisions that the current self has made, then the problem could be more easily accounted, maybe.
It's possible that that would help, but that depends already on giving some credence to the directive. But the Dresser-Robertson position here about the then-self, now-self problem is that if autonomy doesn't matter anymore to the incompetent person, to the now-self, then why should any of these more refined directions that the person put in their directive be needed? What we should do is just address what the best interest of the no longer autonomous, no longer competent, but still conscious person capable of suffering and capable of enjoying, right? The patient as she is now in front of me, that person's best interest, and they, Dresser-Robertson's view is they don't have any interests that simply spill over from their previous wishes. The only interests they have are their current ones based on their current experience. In that case, the directive would be irrelevant. So yes, under some ways of looking at the moral authority and moral importance and legal importance of advanced directives, your refinements that you're suggesting here would make a great deal of difference. But to this view, it's all irrelevant. And just as Fagerlund and Schneider say, there are better and more practical ways of handling this situation of our later incompetence, namely proxies and discussion with people in advance, not written advance directives. So also, Dresser and Robertson say directives are irrelevant. They're morally irrelevant, which is a, now I don't want to just, I have argued along with Rodin, taking Rodin's position that this position is morally wrong, that if we subjected the assumption of it or what it reflects, namely that we shouldn't treat a previously competent person any differently than we would treat a never competent person, if we put that claim out to people, reasonable people, to discuss whether we should differ as a society from that judgment or not, people would reject that judgment. We should treat previously competent people somewhat differently than never competent people. But then, of course, the controversy breaks out. How differently? And always following their directives? Well, not if the directives were ignorant, and certainly not if they weren't fully voluntary. But what other kinds of restrictions would be put on them? My own conclusion from this is that we are not going to escape the significance and importance of advance directives by either the practical issues that Fagerlund and Schneider point out, because some of those issues can be somewhat handled. And we're not going to escape it by this position, because this position would ultimately be rejected by reasonable people and most reasonable people in our society. But I could be wrong about that. Dresser and Robertson think I'm wrong about that. And so the debate goes on. If we think that just by having advanced directives, they're all going to settle down and we're going to have a nice, clear understanding of when they're important, when they're not, and people will write them clearly or not at all. No, there are always going to be these debates about them, which is a common thing for philosophers to say, because we don't mind problems, enduring problems. It's much harder for people on the front lines, families, caregivers, to acknowledge that or fully accept that things are often as contested and ambiguous as this. Sorry, I went on too long in response to your good comment. Other comments? Yes.
I just have questions on the why the advance directive practice was so low in the States even over the years. I just wonder whether it's because of the context. When we do the AAD, I think we have to have an obligation to explain what the situation will be like, based on evidence, latest evidence, treatment modalities, and the outcome. It is done at one time frame. But as the for example, this is an adult, and he may not suffer from that condition as expected. Over the many years, maybe a decade later, he really faced this situation. The technology or the evidence may be different. So I just wonder whether the low uptake of this AD is because the general public have a concern of whether once I sign this form, I will be I will not be treated according to the latest guideline or latest evidence, and might I have missed the opportunity of survival. So that's bring me to think about whether we should update this at interval. For example,
yes.
1990, we are having a disease which cannot be treated, no matter what medication we give. But two decades later, maybe the biologicals, there may be target therapy, which make a difference in the survival. Is there any obligation to renew that advance directive and to make it more relevant in such a context scenarios-based situation? So this is, I think it helped.
If you can write a clearer and more knowledgeable directive, updated by rewriting the previous one, do it. yes, I mean, and you're right. One of the reasons why people might be reticent to write advance directives at all is they say, well, they're always going to be going out of date.
There are many reasons why Americans have been reluctant to create advance directives. One reason is people don't like to think about death at all. Another reason that's often given is they say, well, yes, of course, I'll think about that at the appropriate time. But Karen Quinlan was 21 years old. So the question you make about them going out of not being up to date, I don't think is so much a reason. Another reason I should mention is people think, oh, don't I need a lawyer for that? Which is not the case. It's very easy to get the advance directive forms. So they don't know about them. They don't want to think about it. Those are the biggest reasons. But what you're talking about is the fact, and this is brought out by Fagerlund and Schneider, which is that if you make your advance directive and you say, I don't want this and I don't want that, well, you can't possibly know even 5 or 10 years later what the new treatments are going to be. That's maybe not a reason why people don't make them, but it's certainly a reason why it seems like, why on earth should we follow them? And the problem that Paul didn't emphasize is, if you do put down a lot of specifics, then somebody might say, ah, but she didn't talk about, and then there's something else. So therefore, we can do that. It's much better, in my opinion, to talk more about values and not, I specifically want this medical treatment, because A, you don't know, and you don't know what's going to change. But what you can say is, I don't want to be alive when I don't recognize any member of my family. Or I don't want to be alive when I am suffering a lot. Those are not medical, those are values. And it's probably better. I think most people now think that living wills might be helpful, but it's even better to have someone who has talked to you over the years and knows what your values are as your healthcare proxy to speak for you, because then the doctors can say, well, now we have a new treatment. What do you think mom would say about this? And they can then say it, even though it wouldn't be in a written advance directive.
When you say that, okay, you talk about when there comes a day I can no longer recognize my family members and friends, but this is a very general thing, but it doesn't guide the doctor what to do at that time, whether he should put on ventilator or not.
Because it's as if you were talking to the patient herself. Once you appoint, it's not, I mean, in New York, which is my state that I come from, we have a healthcare proxy bill. In other states, you have to do it through durable power of attorney. You can do it. It's a little bit more difficult.
I don't.
But the advantage of it is, it's as if you were talking to the person herself.
Well, we can imagine it's as if, but it's not. Because the proxy may not fully understand the patient they're speaking for. It depends on how much they know. And we get back to, I think, a larger important point about advance directives. It's better to state something about your values and what are forming and what should help a proxy form your decisions later or express your decisions later than it is to list a lot of details about medical conditions and treatments. If you leave the values and the reasons out of it, you can argue, like Bonnie has argued, that you might as well just have only a proxy. But on the other hand, if the proxy doesn't know what your values were clearly, if you didn't speak to that, if all you say is, I trust this person to interpret my values, but then you never talk with the person about what your values are, then somebody can come in and say, wait a minute, how much did this proxy know about you in a tough situation? So proxies aren't alone the solution. Conversations aren't alone the solution. And advanced directives aren't alone the solution. But I would argue that all three together can help us represent the identity and wishes of the person whom we're now still currently treating, and their past wishes don't just disappear in importance because the now self is different.
I just want to say one more thing that Fagerlund and Schneider said, which is that many of us have no idea what to do in these terrible situations when we're competent. And we have to recognize that. Yeah. These are hard choices that have to be made. Yeah. So the problem with trying to do it in advance is you just magnify those problems, and we shouldn't minimize that problem.
Another reason for saying advance directives are not a magical solution here, even if they're somewhat helpful. Edgar.
Well. 1 minute, because I think everybody wants to go.
We started
minutes
late.
I thought I want to make this point. I think basically advance directive, as you say, is complicated, complex enough that the simpler it is, the better. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now, if the law already said is to be recognized, then those people that disagree with you, with that law, and there are always people disagree with law, mm-hmm. then they can come up with all kind of reasoning and debates and whatever, that's fine. But leave that particular person's decision alone, provided he or she did not make it more complicated. And I will tell you what I meant, by that. Dr. Jie mentioned something about validity. I think the simplest advanced directive would be, and don't forget, there's a point about competency. When you are competent, you can always change your advanced directive. It's not as if you have written something and you cannot change it. It's only when you are incompetent. And when you are incompetent, a lot of people probably when they have written their advanced directive is worrying about when they are incompetent, what they want would not be carried out. So that state, the medical state of being incompetent, is limited to just a number of things. You are in a coma, or you are senile to a certain extent that you cannot make rational decision, so on and so forth. And that I can continue and continue, but I'm not going to do that. I just want to say something very simple. There's a group of people, and the older the person is, the easier it is. I mean, most of the people here are just too young to understand that. There's a group of people, let's say if you pass 60 or 70, 80, 90, decided they have lived long enough and have a very good life. If they become incompetent, they just don't want any treatment. So you don't need to specify saying terminal illness or if I cannot do this. So you just have advanced directive, and the easier it is for older people to do that, and that is, I had a good life. Anything happen, and I'm incompetent, I cannot make any decision, leave me alone. I don't want anything.
No life extended care after I become incompetent and have no prospect of re-emerging into competence.
Yeah.
We'd have to put that one in.
Whatever. But be that as it may, that is the point of Dr. Jie's validity. The simpler the advanced directive, the easier for it to be carried out by the family. Proxy is very difficult because theoretically, you can say the proxy would take away that decision-making from family, which the person that decide on proxy, who to be proxy, is trying to save the family from the agony of making decisions. But then, usually in life cases, it's not like that. But that's another discussion. But I just want to use the word, the simpler, the better. Once you're saying, I don't want certain thing. If certain thing happen, then you complicate the matter.
Thank you. Important comment. I don't agree with all of the things you draw from it, implications, but that's another rich discussion we can carry on. Thank you very much.